welcome to Church Online this morning. So glad that you are here. Pray that your families are well and that you're sitting together ready to worship God, because it doesn't matter where we are, we're still gathered together. So let's have a great morning.
Worship. We use that word a lot, usually when referring to singing, which is a form of worship, because the word worship means to really bow before someone. And so when we sing, we're coming in His presence and lifting Him up. So that is a form of worship. But worship goes way beyond that. It goes to, what do I bow to? For some of us, we really do worship ourselves, because we just surrender to our feelings, our desires, our pleasures, and we go, whatever my body wants, I'm going to go after that. Others, we worship things like popularity, and we just bow down to people and what they want. Some of us, we just want to fit into the culture, or we worship the country or whatever else. But what God says is, look, I want to be your first allegiance. So worship means you surrender to me. You say, my ways are best, and you gladly come under that type of leadership. And at the core of worship, that's what it's all about.
Into your glorious Praise the name of the Lord our God. I surrender. John chapter 6, 35 says, "Then Jesus declared, 'I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty.'" So as we take communion today, let's reflect on the fact that Jesus is the bread of life and that in him we will never be thirsty again. So let's take the elements together and I will close this up in prayer. Pray with me. Hey Jesus, thank you so much for the sacrifice that you made for us. I thank you that we can still be together even though we can't be here physically. And I pray for the week ahead. Amen.
Hello again, Connect Church family. Good to have you with us as we carry on online with church. It's a different way to do church and we are learning as we go. We've changed the backdrop this week. Some people thought we had superimposed the background of the church building last week, so I have set it up the opposite way around so you can see we are on a journey. We're continuing on our journey. This week we start a new series in Mark with Shifting Gears. And so we've been with the prophet Jeremiah for the last month and talking about the Old Testament points to Jesus. It finds its fulfillment in Jesus' sacrifice. And so this week we come to that place and over the next 3 weeks we'll journey with Jesus himself. And so that's where we're heading. We're heading from the Temple Mount to Calvary's Hill. And while we're reading about natural events, as we kind of go through some of the story of the Gospels, we need to understand that spiritually, at this point in time, literally all hell is breaking loose. We're about to head to the key point of all of history. And it's really interesting and timely that we've been learning from Jeremiah. And so on the journey with Jeremiah, we talked about trusting God when life is unfair. And then in the last week, that God's word is eternal and God always fulfills his promise. And so we are coming to the point of seeing the promise fulfilled and the price that Jesus will pay for that. And Jesus chooses to face that. This is a season of strife and struggle for many. And so it's interesting, we've been with Jeremiah talking about the struggles, and now we're with Jesus in the heart of the struggles. For many of you, there'll be challenges related to health and jobs and finance. This is a difficult season for our world. Very challenging. What will the world look like after this season? Will things ever be the same? Do we want them to be the same? Have we been reminded of what's really important in this season, rather than all of the other things that we had previously made important? How thankful will you be after this is all over to hug someone, to high-five a friend, to dance with somebody, to celebrate together, to party with people? So much that we took for granted. I pray that in our world we will learn the lessons that God will help us to learn through this if we open our eyes and open our hearts and we're prepared. So in this season, these next 4 weeks, we move into the heart of the gospel. Next week, Vanessa will share on Easter Sunday. And then we'll look to the ascension. What does that mean for us? that Jesus ascended back to the Father, what does that mean for his followers, for his church here on earth? And then in the last week of this month of April, Phil will come back and he'll be sharing with us on the whole story. You know, Jesus, when he ascended, he said, I'll be back. What does that mean? What's that all about? What are we looking forward to? Today, the church generally celebrates as Palm Sunday, the day when historically Jesus arrived at Jerusalem and was celebrated as he headed into what we call Holy Week, but for him was a hectic week. And so we're going to be in Mark chapter 14. I really encourage you, if you get the opportunity, just to make some notes just now. We're not going to be able to read right through all of this material. I'd encourage you to make time this week to come back and read through Mark from chapter 14, from verse 32 through to the end of that chapter, verse 65. And then make the opportunity to connect with your life group over Zoom or a phone call or talking to one another or FaceTime each other to discuss what we're learning in this process. But let me begin by praying. Heavenly Father, as we open this text, we pray that you would breathe by your Holy Spirit and bring life. God, that your Spirit brings life and that your word would speak to our hearts. God, that we would learn the lessons you intend for us in life and from your word, that we might be truly the followers of Jesus that you call us to be in this community, in this world, at this time, in Jesus' name. Amen. And so in Mark chapter 14, as we go through this, from verse 32. So my New Living Translation has got a little title here. Jesus prays in Gethsemane. They went to an olive grove called Gethsemane. And so the Jesus' followers have been with him as they've celebrated what we now know as the Last Supper. It would have been a lot of confusion for them. They didn't fully understand what was going on. And then Jesus, after that meal, takes them out and they go to the foot, somewhere on the Mount of Olives. And Gethsemane is an olive grove. So they've gone there and in verse 34, Jesus says to his followers, stay here, keep watch with me. Jesus is distressed. He knows what's coming. And in verse 36, it says, Abba, Father, everything is possible for you. Please take this cup of suffering away from me. Everything is possible for God. And then Jesus goes on, yet I want your will to be done, not mine. Wow. Verse after that, Jesus is coming back to his friends and they're all asleep. And Jesus says to them, couldn't you watch with me even for 1 hour? Sometimes I'm convicted by that, you know, when I can't spend some time reading the scriptures, I can't spend some time in the presence of God, I can't spend some time in a prayer meeting, I can't set time aside just to spend with God. That, can you imagine Jesus saying that to you? Couldn't you stay with me even for an hour? Wow. And then he returns to them another couple of times, and on the third time, he just says to them, look, just go ahead and sleep. And in verse 42, look, my betrayer is here. 600 years before this, we go back to around the time of Jeremiah, another prophet, Isaiah, had been a prophet to the nation. And in Isaiah 53, it speaks of this servant, this suffering servant. 600 years before, he was despised and rejected, a man of sorrows. Verse 5, he was pierced for our rebellion, crushed for our sins. He was beaten so we could be whole. He was whipped so we could be healed. This is 600 years before Jesus is even born. He was pierced. How could they How could he know that? All of us, like sheep, have strayed away. We've all left God's path to follow our own way, yet the Lord laid on him the sins of us all. And he is predicting. In verse 7, he was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep is silent before the shearers, he did not open his mouth. And this is 600 years before, prophesying what Jesus will go through. And Jesus chose, the first point of today's message from Mark 14 is that Jesus chose to surrender to God's will. In the garden, when he says, look, you could take this suffering away from me, Father, but it's not about my will. I want your will to be done. And with his friends falling asleep and not even supporting him, in the face of disappointment, Jesus still chooses the Father's way. Is that true about you and I? So many people I've known over the years, when faced with the disappointment, people in church life letting them down, people in the world letting them down, things not going the way they wanted, given up on their faith, given up on following Jesus. When people face the challenges like we're facing now of losing a job, health challenges, financial challenges. If that's our situation now, will we still choose the Father's way? You know, the people around us who don't know Jesus are watching us. They want to see how do we respond? This is our opportunity to represent Jesus. In spite of the trials, will we be at peace? Will we be surrendered to the will of God? And so Mark carries on. I love Mark's gospel. I think Mark is probably the disciple with ADD. He goes through things so quickly, there's so much action, everything's happening. So in verse 43 through to 52, it has the title, Jesus is betrayed and arrested. And so in verse 45, we see Judas had given them a prearranged signal. You'll know which one to arrest when I greet him with a kiss. And so as they arrived, Judas walked up to Jesus. Rabbi, he exclaimed, and gave him a kiss. I have no idea what Judas must have gone through. Virtually as soon as that was over, we get a sense of the regret of Judas. And Jesus, in the midst of all of this, am I some dangerous revolutionary that you come with swords and clubs? Why didn't you arrest me in the temple? I was there among you teaching every day. But he goes on to say, these things are happening to fulfill what the scriptures, like Isaiah 53, say about me. You see, the Old Testament is talking about the Messiah. It's talking about Jesus. And in the midst of all of this, Jesus continues to be faithful in the face of betrayal. And so as we read on in this, Jesus' friends bailed. They ran. They left him. What about you? Have friends betrayed you? Have you felt in life that you've been let down and betrayed? What's even worse is if you reflect honestly, who have you betrayed? Who have you let down? The reality is betrayal has no winners. You know, revenge has no winners. It's a cold dish. It's cold-hearted. Nobody wins. Judas, in the end, takes his own life. He cannot handle the pain of his own betrayal of Jesus. And we look at our world today, social media. I don't know if you've looked at much recently, but there's so much good that can be done. I love being able to connect with people globally, people I know. But so often, there is so much evil, vitriol, people tearing people apart. People who don't deal with issues, but attack people's character. And it's terrible. And so we have to use that tool with wisdom. And we need to understand that people will fail us. But the truth is, God never will. The question for us is, will we continue to be faithful when circumstances and people let us down? Will we trust that God will never let us down? And we carry on in Mark chapter 14 in this next section where Jesus is taken before the high priest. Interestingly, Peter, who has run away and not really been present for Jesus, but he's following at a distance. And so Jesus ends up being dragged before the council. And the high council are trying to find evidence against Jesus, but they can't find anything to condemn him. And finally, in verse 57, it says they got some men who will bring a false testimony. But in verse 59, even they can't get the story straight. So the whole case against him is falling apart, and Jesus stands silently. The high priest stood up before the others and asked Jesus, "Aren't you going to answer these charges? What do you have to say for yourself?" But Jesus was silent and made no reply. Then the high priest asks a key question. "Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One?" Then Jesus breaks his silence. And he says simply, "I am. And you will see the Son of Man seated in the place of power at God's right hand and coming on the clouds of heaven." Well, then chaos erupts. Literally, as we said before, all hell breaks loose. And people are going crazy. The high priest tears his robes and yells out blasphemy. "What do you people say?" And they say he's guilty. And he deserves to die. Then some of them began to spit at him. They blindfolded him and beat him with their fists. And as he's dragged off, the guards slapped him as they took him away. So Jesus is before the high council, lies are being told about him, and in the midst of it all, Jesus is quiet. Why? He doesn't call down angels, he doesn't raise an army. This is all unfair, it's illegal, and he makes no complaint. But Isaiah has predicted this, that he will, like a lamb to the slaughter, be silent before his accusers, and Jesus is. But when he's asked the key question, Jesus tells the truth despite knowing the consequences that he will face. He is quiet until he is asked, "Who are you?" And then Jesus, who is the truth, tells the truth. And all too often, truth is actually not what the world wants to hear. And so it sent this crowd into a rage. Why is the world so hostile to the truth? Well, the reality is, in our journey through the world system, we are brainwashed, we're misled, misdirected. We're told untruth, built upon untruth. I don't know if you ever saw the film The Matrix. Can't believe it's over 20 years old now. But the circumstance where Neo, Keanu Reeves' character, is presented with a choice: choose a red pill or a blue pill. The red pill will open his eyes to the truth of what's really going on. The blue pill, well, he'll just carry on in compliance with the false world that he believes he lives in. And so, of course, he takes the red pill. And for us, the red pill, it's a symbol of salvation. Our eyes are open to the truth, open to Jesus, who is the truth. But we may find that other people, they don't want that choice. We may find that their response to us sharing the gospel is they prefer compliance with the world system. They don't want to tackle all of the realities around them. It's a stressful journey facing the truth. They'd rather live and continue on the journey that they've been on, where the emperor has no clothes. As you read Mark 14 this week, I want to ask you to ask yourself the three questions from the three points that have come out of this message today. Firstly, how surrendered am I to God's will for my life? It's a big question. But in the time frame that we live in, we have time to actually slow down, to stop, to examine what are the things that are important to me, what are the things that God says are important, and how surrendered am I? In coming out of this season, will I continue to walk in surrender to God? Secondly, am I faithful to God even when I'm feeling betrayed? Do I allow my emotions to dictate my journey with God or faith? Am I faithful even when I'm feeling betrayed? And then thirdly, as Jesus has shown here, will I speak truth despite the consequences? Despite knowing there's a price to pay for the truth. I would say alongside that though, in Ephesians 4, Paul encourages us to speak the truth in love. So as followers of Jesus, let love be your motive and be a blessing to others this week. Examine your own heart. Ask yourself the questions. And then seek to be a blessing to others. I pray that this speaks to you and that you get the opportunity to connect with others this week and discuss it further. I pray the Lord blesses you as you journey with all of us together in separate places. Be blessed in Jesus' name. Amen.